Radio Dunedin. Time to meet our guest in the studio, and this is a gentleman I told you was coming to talk to us from his background in IT, which means computers and technological things, and music and other things in life, which we'll find about. Keith Lightfoot, good morning and welcome.
Good morning, Neil.
You have travelled up from Gore this morning?
I certainly have. It was a beautiful day to drive up.
Now, you made a choice to live down there, inland from Gore itself?
I live in Pukerau, right. Actually.
So what was behind that choice to make your life?
Yes, it's an interesting question, isn't it? People have often used the term, why Pukerau?
Well, I say that in your case because you're a speaker, a very good speaker from what I've read, a motivational speaker, which people like you are in demand, and there you are tucked in at Pukerau. Inland from Gore.
Yes. Pukerau is one of New Zealand's villages, deserted villages. Used to be a thriving community, now it's crumbling wooden houses with rusty roofs. If we were in England, we would have villages with double brick houses and tile roofs and stone fences, and it would be quaint and beautiful, but we have all these lovely settlements in New Zealand that nobody wants to live in anymore. And unfortunately, or fortunately, we built them out of wood and tin, and so now they look a little bit derelict. And hopefully the owners of the current houses do not look a little bit derelict. So we moved down there because it's very peaceful and because actually we were in a situation financially where we needed somewhere we could afford. We tried to be sensible about that. We had some things owing, so we wanted to clear out some debts. And we moved there to a beautiful community called Pukerau, and we absolutely love it.
But how did you choose Pukerau?
Yes, that's a good question, isn't it?
Because when you say you moved down there, is this from the North Island?
Or we moved down from Christchurch before the earthquakes. And we moved to Pukerau. We were looking...
That was a good decision then.
Yes, we were looking around the South Island particularly, moving further and further south with our map and deciding where to go. We, on a Friday evening, late Friday evening, we had a call from a real estate agent in Gore to say, would you consider living in Pukerau? And we said, send us the photographs. So he sent through some photographs of a house through the internet. We looked at the photographs. My wife, Andrea, saw the first photograph and said, that's what we're looking for. We went through the rest of the photographs, called him back and said, we'll take it. And he said, you haven't seen it yet. And we said, we've seen the photographs, it's ours.
Really?
And so he faxed up a contract, we signed the contract and sent it back to him. And we then drove down and had a look at it.
And we are still happy?
Yes, indeed. Contracts like that have a clause in that says if the photographs are not representative of the house you saw, then it's an old 1926 villa in need of some tender loving care, which we intend to do over a period of time. And we've got
which just wouldn't have been all that expensive, Keith?
No. I think a budget would be the expression used here.
Certainly,
DIY special.
Mm-hmm. One would tend to think when you mention a place like that, that being inland there and you're buying a farmlet or a small acreage or something like that.
Yes, that's a nice dream. My wife's very much into birds, so we're like a little private SPCA down in Pukerau. She rescues sparrows. She seems to be able to speak to the birds. I'm slightly confused about that. I don't understand the language either of them are speaking. And so I can walk outside and she'll be patting a sparrow on the clothesline, which is a quite unusual thing to see. She'll wander around with a cuckoo in her hand, or she'll be holding a blackbird, or it's really...
And
so
nice. Yeah.
It is just beautiful to watch. So we have birds indoors, we have parrots indoors, and we have doves outside, and we have wild birds. I'm not sure if we go to the grocery shop for us or for the birds these days, but either way, we do it.
Are you isolated? Have you made friends of the humankind?
Yes, we have, very much. And that's been quite a surprise for us. We lived in Christchurch for a long time and had a lot of beautiful friends up there, but they weren't our neighbours. And now we have beautiful friends that are our neighbours. And so that's been an interesting turnaround for us. And so we have chickens, of course they're birds, so we would. And so we have eggs and some people don't. So we give them eggs and they give us homemade chutney. And
sure.
So and this goes on.
That's lovely, isn't it?
And we have people popping in, not every day, they don't live in their pocket, but it's just a beautiful relationship in the community. I haven't experienced that before.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a bit of a city slicker, you know, suit and tie.
Yeah, so it is a change, isn't it?
Oh, it's a massive change.
Yeah.
Massive. Andrea clicked in immediately. She was brought up on a farm, and she clicked in instantaneously into this lifestyle. And we have, we have almost half an acre, so we have kind of bushes and birds and stuff, and lots of gardening to do. And she clicked in immediately, whereas I was wondering where the high-rises were and what would happen to all the desks and partitions and the computers and stuff. And so we set up shop, and it would be hard to get us out of the place now.
You haven't quite mastered the Southland horror yet.
I was actually raised in Invercargill for most of my life.
Oh, well, you know about it then.
I do.
Information technology, to take a sip of your coffee, Keith, information technology, to people like me, I can master enough to get going. I could get into second gear, but getting me to third and top is beyond me, it's still at my age. But you were quite proficient in that, and that's the thing about living anywhere today. You can live anywhere, because as long as your computer and your database, and you can get the whatever it is, the fiber optics to your house, you're in business.
That's exactly right. That is true, and we're very fortunate to have that career. I mean, I stumbled into the career very early in life. In fact, I popped down to the Leviathan Hotel on my way here, which is very near to your premises, as you know, and went in and met the owner, a man called Peter. And so there's a Leviathan promo for him. And so I popped in there because in 1970, I went on a computer programming course there. So I was an early pioneer in the industry. I stumbled in through an aptitude test, which for some reason I passed very highly on. And then computers weren't around. There was no such thing, mainframes only, no computer magazines, no computers, nothing going on. And so that's been part of my life, and I'm very comfortable with it. And now we have it that I can live in Pukerau and use a small desktop PC and exist and make a living.
Well, I'm sure Peter Lang could do that with all his visitors coming from all over the world or over the place. Make sure their accommodation's right and let them know. It's a wonderful tool. I mean, we never heard of this 30 years ago, 40 years ago, to the extent that it's used today. Of course, it brings in all sorts of little irritations like scamming and things like that. And spamming is the other thing, isn't it?
Yes.
Which I understand... Telecom had some bother not long ago with iHug, and there's a letter going around to people even today saying we thought we'd cleared it up last time, but some of it's still happening, so it sounds like it's coming back to bite them again. So they're the irritations of information technology, no doubt, Keith.
Very much so. Now we're seeing antivirus programs being released for your cell phone. So we've now, I mean, who would ever imagine that an antivirus program was needed in the first place?
Not me.
and now we have it that you need it on your cell phone, because somebody can infiltrate your cell phone and get access to your contact details and your bank accounts or whatever else. And it's early days in the cell phone infiltration arena, but it's now starting to begin. And so, and as you say, the technology, because it's so portable now and because of my familiarity with it, it's been a real blessing that I'm able to put that into a musical sense. And so we're able to do home recordings from our 1926 villa that would sound like they've come out of what used to be a professional studio.
It's amazing. Now, your life as a motivational speaker, in fact, you've been described as unique and truly one of a kind. I mean, I think we're all one of a kind, aren't we, really? But to travel around confronting people, how did that come about?
I was afraid of motivational speaking. Well, I was afraid of speaking, as most people are. It's apparently the number one fear in the world. Second is death by fire. So it's kind of an interesting comparison. So people would rather that somebody else spoke and did the eulogy at their funeral than actually do it themselves. It's wild. So I've started running a number of public speaking courses as a result. And so I joined JC's many years ago in order to get over the fear of public speaking. And it used to be a professional organisation that taught those kind of things. And slowly but surely I got over the fear, then I realised it was something that was holding people back. Because once you can conquer what is a major fear in your life, it opens you up to all sorts of possibilities. And so I try and reach into other people's lives now and break that fear they have inside them and set them free. And it's, you can see people change. Their whole life changes because that one thing goes away. That, you know, it's my brother's wedding, I have to speak at it, what am I going to do? The fear lives in them for months.
Toastmasters really tries to help people through that too, doesn't
Absolutely.
It?
Absolutely. You know? Absolutely it does. I think JC's no longer, isn't it?
Possibly. I'm a bit on the other side of the fence. I've spoken to all the Toastmasters groups and the Rotaries and the others like you have, the Lions Clubs and things over the years, but not quite in your field, which is quite specific, and you've got to be able to inject humour when you feel it's needed to relax people, obviously. And there is a system and the PowerPoints today and things like
that's
that.
That's right. That's exactly right.
Yes. And so you can be picked up and moved to a motor conference or something like that, or a dealer's conference somewhere else?
That's right.
The type of thing you're doing?
That's right, yes. In fact, I had a phone call yesterday for a conference I'm going to be doing in Auckland in May, and getting with a group of people, some senior management people and some of their team, and just providing an injection of enthusiasm and motivation for the team, but also talk about connectivity skills. Some of the old school stuff that's getting lost through emails and text messages. People have lost the art of eye contact, of handshakes, of a smile, of that kind of first connection point that's really important. First impressions are still a really important part of life, and yet we hide behind our screens now and our computers and our phones these days and send text messages which are, can only be received and read and the voice inflection and the emotion of the receiver, not in the sender. And we receive messages often completely different to the person that sent it.
Mm-hmm.
And then relationships break up, things happen just through written words. It's incredible to watch.
You obviously are very good at your craft and doing that, and that can be your source of income, I guess, too.
Absolutely.
You're not the only one doing it. There's a whole lot of people doing this type
That's
of
right.
thing. And the more well-known doing it extremely well at it, successfully, financially, and things like that. So it is a basis to what you do, your life as you're living it today.
Absolutely.
Dream, if you like.
That's right. It's the IT performs the major part of what I do, because it's I work for a company called Wide Internet Group, and so we do website development, stuff like that,
sure.
around New Zealand. And that's the kind of foundation of what I do in life. And then on top of that, I have the speaking and the assisting the speaking and the motivation and stuff like that goes, things on top of that. But as you know, the industries like public speaking or music, or it's an incredibly difficult industry to, you get peaks and troughs, so one month somebody can be massively successful and they're doing really well, and you know, the next minute, they're wondering what on earth happened, and
depression
and so then 3 months of no income, and then one week of income, and then 2 months of no income, and it's an incredible thing to get through. Yeah. So,
but like that for entertainers, along with your fear of the fear of speaking in public to groups of people for the first time or whatever, I would imagine that a stand-up comic, and there's a lot of them around today more than there used to be, in the middle of an act, who starts getting heckled, and that could be incredibly difficult to overcome if you're a little nervous about your act and you're doing it and then you start getting heckled by some smart ass in the audience. What do you advise people to do there?
I'm not a person who's probably experienced a great deal of hecklers.
Not in your line, but for the comic.
Yeah, for the comic.
He's in public, he's in front of people.
Yes. I think every person has their own way of doing it. I've noticed on YouTube there are a few people who resort to stripping the person down and ripping them apart in front of the audience in order to win their point. And that seems to gain a lot of YouTube viral hits, this kind of clinical destroying of, of a member. And that doesn't work with me in my head, that kind of stuff.
If I could interrupt you, I think it would be the same for an entertainer and a singer and a performer. I was at a concert just 2 weeks ago, and the star of that particular part of the show, and he just got going and he said, "Join in, you'll know this, you can sing along." You know, getting everybody on side, and people did sing along, and just as a wise crack at the end, he said, "Was that you singing? Could I hear anyone?" And a guy just sitting along from me just boorishly called out at the top of his voice, "You do the singing, we'll do the applause. We paid for the tickets, you haven't." And I just thought, what a violently rude thing to do. And nobody reacted to it, and in fact, it just was a downer. But the singer then had to do the rest of his whole act, you know, and that was just boorish and to do that. But he had to overcome it, and, and obviously he was quite seasoned. He'd been around the boards for a lot of years and just pulled a face, did a nod, and carried on.
It would still be in that person's head on stage, because you're looking to...
Yes, it would have been.
Whenever you're doing anything, and including speaking or singing or whatever the entertainer's doing, you're reading the audience constantly. Once you get over the fear of speaking or singing or acting or whatever's going on, you're looking at the audience and trying to give them what they want, not what you're trying to deliver. And so, as you know, people react different ways. You can actually pick it up, even if you can't see them. And so to have somebody yelling out in that kind of manner, in a negative tone, can change the feeling for the artist as well. And the audience may not have got the concert they were hoping to get out of it. So I'm not a person who likes to put people down in any way, shape, or form. So I've had people ask me some tricky questions during my talks, because some people give me a hard time for being far too positive, which is a really strange thing, because nobody puts you down for being far too negative.
And that's a bit sad.
Isn't it?
You've written a book, You've written a book.
I have.
And thank God it's Friday, which is an oft-heard expression. Why did you choose that name? And how does that fit into the picture?
Yeah. The book took 2 years to write. Well, it took a lifetime to write, obviously, but it took 2 years to write, and I rewrote it three times, and the title just wasn't coming. And then I realised that the essence of the book was about waking up each morning and being thankful that you're alive and having a great day, with, as opposed to thanking it on Friday. The stats show us that people are 10% happier on a Friday than any other day of the week. And so I don't get that. That doesn't work for me, because each day is a day. And so my book, in one of the chapters, talks about that, why not say thank God it's Tuesday, or thank goodness it's Monday, or why thank goodness it's Wednesday, and get yourself in the mood for the day. So that was the idea. Are you grumpy or grateful for the day? You know, you wake up and saying, oh no, it's Monday, or you say, wow, it's Monday. You know, the two expressions can cause your day to go one way or the other.
You explore in the book the secret of success. Is there a secret?
Yeah, I think there is a secret. I don't think it's that difficult,
you
actually.
You go looking for it? Oh, well, it's not that difficult, you say.
No, I don't think it's that difficult, actually. I mean,
just being positive.
Having a good attitude is really important. Attitude is everything, and it will affect what you do with your life in terms of your physical and emotional through the day. I mean, you can act yourself into a feeling as opposed to filling yourself into an action. Mm-hmm. In other words, if you're sitting at a party somewhere, if you've been somewhere where someone says, come and dance, you don't want to, and you say, I don't want to dance. Come on, have a dance. I don't want to dance. Come on, Neil, I don't want to dance. And then when you get up and dance, that you can't get off the floor. Because when you finally get up, you feel enthusiastic because you're acting enthusiastic. And so this whole process of, you know, are happy people happy because they whistle? Or do they whistle because they're happy? And they've worked out that people who sing and whistle are actually happier, even when they were when they started. Because you can act yourself into that feeling just a little bit more. So
We do tend to bump into a lot of people, though, that are happy being miserable. Misery loves company. Indeed. Well, just move to another phase of your life.
Sure.
Before we wind up here today, Keith. And you've written a song and recorded it.
Yes.
Just showing how multifaceted and multi-talented you are, sir. You called it Home. Was that a working title, or how did this all come about? Indeed.
The songs tend to come very much out of my emotions, and so they're from the heart. The song is, as you probably know, because we've talked about it, it's going to be part of the SPCA album in 2013, and that's a very humbling position for me to be at, because it's going to be alongside some of the great Kiwi icons that I grew up with and watched on black and white television, then on colour television. And so to have Keith Lightfoot alongside some of these names is wild from my perspective. Gray Bartlett heard the song, and Gray has been very supportive of what I'm doing. He's become a great friend of mine. And he heard it and he said, I really like it. It came about because Andrew was away. And I was just thinking to myself, I was sitting around and I had my ukulele and doing my stuff, and I was feeding all the birds and keeping the house tidy and keeping the place warm and cooking the meals. And it just dawned on me that tomorrow, again, I'll be home with my tomorrows. And I really haven't got a clue. You know, I haven't got a clue compared to what Andrew does around the place. I'm sure many people feel that when their spouse is away.
Was it a Friday?
I don't know if it was a Friday. And the song came almost instantly out of that.
Yes.
The words just started to flow. And then it struck me, you could say this was a negative thought, but it struck me, what would it be like if she never came home? And so the song moves on to the pattern of, you know, what would it feel like if that partner that isn't there and you're home with your tomorrows wasn't there? And so it just came out of that kind of humble beginning. And I ran it past Gray, and he said, wow, that's actually a really good song. So we recorded it professionally. He liked it enough to think it should be included, and so
it's on a CD called Gray Bartlett's Kiwi Icons. It's due for release in June, and as you say, proceeds are going to the SPCA. And there's some fine company on there. You're in good company.
Good grief, I'll say.
Yeah, there's some big names, John Rowles, Eddie Lowe, and Suzanne Donaldson, and a number of others, so you're in good company, and your track is called Home, and we'll leave it there. I know there's obviously a lot more to listening to you, and a lot more we could find out, but we'll keep that for another day, Keith, and thank you for coming up, especially to have a chat to us here. And you've got a website. We might as well let people know that you have got your own website, and there's all sorts of things on there, photographs and reviews, and you might be on here one day talking to our listeners at Radio Dunedin. So what is the website?
The best one, if they want to hear the song, is keithlightfoot.com. And so that's actually got a music video on there as well for the new song, so they can actually, and that links to another site called Hardwick Enterprises for the photographs and videos you talked about. And it's been a pleasure to come up. It's always a pleasure to come to Dunedin. I love it here. You drive over that hill and you look down into the bay, and it's a wild place to drive into, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. And it's good to meet interesting people such as yourself. So keithlightfoot.com will do the trick.
It'll yes, absolutely.
Get you up there. Thanks for coming in. We'll end up with home, shall we?
And thank
you'll
be
making your way home soon.
I appreciate it.
Home with my tomorrows. Home, home without a clue. Just isn't home.